two outsiders, or their more politically active contemporaries, this set bent on enjoying themselves seems scandalously decadent. The Romantics see themselves more as creative.
In January 1981, at the height of another recession, Newsnight reporter Robin Denslow headed down to the Blitz Club to chronicle this new youth cult. He spoke to a young Steve Strange about what was going on there.
The whole idea is complete change, all the time moving on with the music, with the clothes, with the styles.
It is all an escape from the miserable political and economic realities outside.
Nobody should knock fantasy and escape in that 9-to-5 job and dressing like a Hollywood film star and expressing themselves, because they're getting away from it and they're having a good time.
Behind the posing and the dressing up, the New Romantics are, at the very least, optimistic and creative. And at least someone's trying to dispel all the gloom.
The Blitz was a hothouse. The temperature in that room, in every sense, was at boiling point.
Robert Elms again.
It was incredibly creative, unbelievably competitive. And therefore, you were driven on. And isn't that fabulous when you're 18, 19? When the rest of the country is sitting around saying, oh, I'm unemployed, I'm bored, I ain't got a job, I can't do anything. You couldn't have that attitude in the Blitz.
The combination of people within that club was the most exciting thing.
Gary Kemp again.
You know, I didn't know their faces then, but all of these people would go on to become huge in their areas in the 1980s. Here's an example. I got a shirt off a young kid that he'd made, a big blousy piratical number, and inside it he'd scrawled his name in felt-tip pen. It just said Galliano.
Loads of people I saw down at the Blitz Club went on to make names for themselves, like Boy George, who was the coat check boy before he became a pop star. His sidekick Marlon sold cigarettes. Dylan Jones, the current editor of GQ, was another Blitz kid.
There was an entrepreneurial spirit. I mean, looking back on it these days, we were all young Thatcherites. But of course, we would have hated that sort of term at the time. But that's what everyone was doing, because we were getting on our bikes and we were forging careers for ourselves.
The Spandau Ballet Boys did just that. They made their debut at the Blitz and used it to launch their hugely successful pop careers. Robert Elms was there at the beginning and watched it all happen.
They put on a rehearsal one Saturday afternoon in some dodgy studios on the Holloway Road, invited me, Steve Strange, and a couple of other people to come and see them. They sang their first song, which went do 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 do, and I thought, blimey, they're good. Afterwards, in the pub, Steve said, we've got to get a name. I said, oh, you should call him Spandau Ballet. And he went to Gary, do you fancy Spandau Ballet? It sounds right. And he went, yeah, all right then. That kind of metronomic, Teutonic disco sound was the beat of the Blitz. And it was ballet, which was as anti-rock and roll as you can be.
Spandau Ballet headlined the Blitz Christmas party of 1979. Steve Dagger, who hung out with the guys at the Blitz and who later became their manager, realised they had made a breakthrough.
The idea of any group playing in the Blitz was impossible at that time. There wasn't a group for that audience, it didn't exist. So we were very concerned about, would that audience, which was quite small and discerning, actually like Spandau Ballet, and we didn't know. But that Christmas party was quite a buzz, and it was great. The band went down very well there, but there were all sorts of people who were getting in there and trying to see what was going on.
That was the first gig of Spandau Ballet.
I heard that after being to the Blitz, your manager came back and said to you, go buy a synthesizer.
Yeah.
Is that true, Gary?
We weren't really sure what direction we were going in. At the Blitz, it was, we've got to buy a synthesizer. This is for us.
We wanted to be modern. Punk was rock and roll and guitars. There was never a guitar heard in the Blitz. It was synthesizers and electronics. Anyone can play a synthesizer. And it makes a sound that is sharp and clean and all very brittle. And that's what this place was.
I'll never forget the first time I saw a synthesizer. It was on Tomorrow's World and it blew me away. This electronic keyboard that could be programmed to create computer-generated sounds, it was just so exciting to me, because for the first time I saw the possibility to create sounds that had only existed in my head. Until now, I had no chance of getting my hands on one, because they were either the size of a house or at least the cost of one. But in the early 80s, cheaper Japanese synths came on the market, so when I had the opportunity, I bought one. It changed my life because now I could make music in my small home studio, and the possibilities for young musicians like myself seemed endless. But first, we had to break down the barriers of disapproval from the old guard.
A lot of people were so against synthesizers and had so many silly things to say about them, but, you know, being not proper music, and people stuck in a different era, I think.
Blitz regular Gary Numan is considered to be the first king of British electropop. He broke new ground with his track Cars, which reached number one in 1979 with no guitars on it. Instead, he used synthesizers to generate the sounds on the track.
Musicians Union tried to ban me. They said I was putting musicians out of work. And I said, how do you work that out? What string quartet would I have got in the studio to go, bleh? Because nothing else does it. You know, strings player doesn't make that noise. We're looking at noises. And I'm saying in interviews, I can't play music. You know, I can't write music. I'm just doing this. And I'm number one, you know. So kids are going, whoa, you know, well, if he can do that and get to number one, then so can I. And everybody went and did it. And it absolutely exploded, you know. Everyone saw the sense of it eventually.
Well, I'm sitting here in my studio in front of a variety of video screens, some speakers, fairly hefty computer by my side, and a very small keyboard here. This is a soft synth, which is just a software program inside a computer. Now, some of the sounds in this are electronic sounds, the same type of sounds that we used back in the early 80s. Now, that is meant to be a snare drum. It sounds nothing like a snare drum. It's a very specific sound and lack of feel, this cold European soulless sound became something that was sought after, that drummers couldn't emulate. Only a machine could do this. You know, everyone aspired to be a robot. You know, we didn't want any human element in there at all. So people sang in a very kind of robotic way. You know, people played in a very robotic way. There was no doubt that it wasn't going to sound like Jimi Hendrix. It was going to sound like, you know, a watered-down version of Kraftwerk. My obsession with the synthesizer led to the breakup of the new wave band I was in at the time. After that, I went off and did some electronic demos with Rusty Egan, which turned into Visage. Visage was never really a proper band. It was just a group of our favourite musicians who we brought together to make experimental music for the Blitz Club. The musicians were all signed to other labels, so we needed a frontman. We chose Steve Strange because he looked the part. Our breakthrough song, Fade to Grey, started life as a Blitz anthem, but it went on to reach number one in 18 countries.
We thought Visage could be an entity that could make a video and would have a frontman singer celebrity that would do all the radios.
And that frontman was?
Steve. And we could just make the music, really.
Now, Rusty, if I remember right, the first video cost £1,500, most of which was spent on Steve's makeup. But the video itself for Fade to Grey was kind of groundbreaking. It was the beginning of MTV.
Well,
they had nothing to show, so they were showing videos that we had created, we had put together.
What we did here at the Blitz was a lot of talented people fighting to get recognised.
A voice reaching out in a piercing cry, it stays with you until...
The Blitz era was an incredibly vibrant time for me. I ended up joining the band Ultravox while I was also working on Visage, and amazingly, both bands charted at the same time, with hit songs featuring sounds generated by the synthesizer. The synth sound had gone mainstream, and our Blitz bands were at the forefront of the British synth pop revolution.